Welcome to Successful Philanthropy. I'm Jean Shafiroff, your host. This show is all about philanthropy and its leaders. With us today is Dan Gasby. He's a businessman, a philanthropist, and an all-around wonderful person. Dan, thank you so much for being with us. Can you tell us a little bit about your life with B. Smith? B. Smith, a famous woman known as the Martha Stewart of the black community. She was a lifestyle guru, model, actress, an all-around wonderful woman. And later in life, she developed Alzheimer's at a very young age. What was it like?
Well, let me, first of all, thank you for having me on your show. I look forward to being here. Having the pleasure of having spent 28 years with Barbara Smith, better known as B. Smith, was one of the most remarkable things that I could possibly imagine 25 years ago, because we were doing so many different things and we were living life so with so much fun and joy. I never thought what I'd ultimately have to experience. She was amazing. We went 18 years and never had an argument. We built businesses, we had restaurants, we had a radio show, we had a two TV shows. We have licensing businesses that still to this day are very viable. But the woman is, can only be described as she was lace and she was steel. She was a strong person with a kind heart. She was everything that you would want in a mate. And she was a person that when the times got tough, she stood beside you. She wouldn't run. And I've learned how important knowing and having someone in your life who's not weak or who's not afraid.
Yes, and you were partners together. Not only were you lovers, were you marriage partners, but you worked in business together. Correct?
Yes.
Not in the beginning, but I think later on in
the marriage? It evolved as I started to see things that were going on in her business life, and I realized that there were some injustices, and she asked me to get involved, and it took off from there.
And what kind of injustices? Were these racial injustices?
When you're black in America, you always have this 800-pound, quote-unquote, gorilla of being black and having to deal with people that don't think you are deserving or don't believe you own it or don't believe you're smart enough. It's a constant situation. But she was strong, and that's the thing. When I look back over my life now, relationships I've had, I appreciate that she wasn't a weak person and she couldn't handle pressure. She could handle anything.
Well, I remember your wife as being someone very beautiful. She was someone who would light up a room like you never see before. And also very stoic and very strong. And you were with her all the time. I remember that also. Mm-hmm. You don't remember this, but we met many, many years ago at a charity event. We were sitting at the same table together, and it was at the Bridgehampton Country Club.
Oh, right, right.
And I just was so impressed with the two of you, and I was really, truly delighted to have been seated with you. But yes, being a black and being in America, especially now, everything coming to the forefront. But people are talking about it more freely.
Finally.
And I think it's a good thing, because I think that a lot of who are not in your situation don't understand. They don't realize that life is more difficult, or they didn't realize. And so I think to have an open conversation about this for our viewers, I think is a good thing. But before we talk about that, let's go back to your life with B. And the two of you, so you met, you were, I don't know how old, and...
Well, I met her, the beauty of it was, I met her at a Valentine's Day I was having with my, at the time, wife, who ultimately left me, but she was impressed that I brought presents on Valentine's Day and then presented them individually, from flowers before the salad, and Chanel No. 5 back in those days, which was a big item before the soup came, and then a pearl necklace. And one of the waitresses told her about what I had done, and I'd come in at 5 o'clock, and we want to have dinner at 7. And so that's how I first met her. And when I first looked at her,
so you were with your first wife.
I was with my first wife.
And you were showering your wife with all these beautiful gifts.
Exactly.
It was like a little bit of a melody.
It was a total melody. It was a song. I was trying to be the orchestra director and trying to play the symphony of romance. And
what woman doesn't love that?
Well, you're right.
I mean, most women on Valentine's Day, they're just happy to be with somebody. And then, So your wife was with you, and so you met B then, and
yeah,
I guess maybe...
Well, this is the thing that I really want to impress upon you, Jean. I had never met anyone that had a smile that was like a three-tiered light. The closer she got, the bigger the smile got. And then when she looked at you, it was like it went from 50 to 100 watts to 500, not even 150 to 500. And when she smiled at you, you know what love is, and you know what nice, what decency is. And she was so confident. And I think that's the big thing that I remember, is that she was confident, she was kind. She was a good woman. She was a great woman. And when she walked in the room, candles would flicker. And that was the thing that made me, and this
you
is
you fell in love. It sounds like you
But
fell.
I didn't fall in love then. The thing I said to myself was, man, I wish I had somebody in my family just like that. And as things would go on, my wife left me. She got an annulment from her then husband. And I had created a TV show with Natalie Cole that she did this little song called Unforgettable.
We all remember that.
And I had the show and this whole situation, and the show was canceled 2 weeks before that album came out, and it was the biggest of the 80s. But as they say, when one door closes, another opens. I was living on the West Coast, coming back to the East Coast. She had heard about the show, she had heard about what was going on, and I walked into her restaurant, and she basically looked at me and said, you did everything you could. And, you know, it'll be okay. And as time happened, I asked her, would you like to have lunch or go to a movie? And she said yes. And we didn't connect, but I kept coming back and trying to ask for a date. And finally, I went one day, came in. I went to the bathroom. She came back from being downstairs at her office. And she was hugging a guy so good looking, I would have dated him. And I'm not gay or bi. And I just gave up. And then 5 months later, while I was sitting at a little bistro up on the Upper West Side, she jumps out of a white Jeep, and her girlfriend, and they were both stunning. Her friend had a double-breasted blazer, had skin-tight jeans and heels, had back then cornrows that were just immaculate. And Barbara had on what always made me smile, turn me on. She had on cat pants with the stirrups, and they were all white. And I had never seen a woman wear not a double-breasted blazer. She had a triple-breasted blazer. So there were buttons on the outside and buttons down the middle. And she had a naval officer's hat. And I asked, could I hang out with them? And they said no. And then I asked for a hug. She gave me a hug. And then she pushed me back. And she says, you know, your life might take a turn for the better if you make a phone call. I made a phone call. We met at a little restaurant that was legendary back in the day called Cafe Cielo on 8th Avenue and 52nd Street. And I fell in love with her. Took her to see my health club up where Le Bernardin is.
Mm-hmm.
I walked her to 52nd Street and 7th Avenue. Kissed her on the cheek. She had on a houndstooth suit with a big white hat with a black brim. It was light below her eyes. And I walked 5 steps away, turned around, and she was staring at me. And we were together ever since then.
And how many years ago was that?
Oh, God, that was 30 years ago.
And you had a very long marriage, and I understand she just passed away in February.
Yes.
But it was a beautiful marriage, and then at the end, when your wife developed Alzheimer's, she was sick for what, 6 or 7 years?
Oh no, she was sick for close to 12 years, but we kept it quiet until, because we didn't know what was going on. We thought maybe she was depressed. We thought maybe she was having a nervous breakdown, because we didn't do what people need to do when they start to see cognitive dissonance, when they start to see things that are not making sense, when people start to repeat themselves, when people start forgetting things, when people suddenly have tremendous mood swings out of nowhere and then settle back down. I didn't know anything about that. And I thought she needed a time out. I thought she needed to get away. I thought she didn't love me anymore. I mean, all of those things, but it wasn't psychological. It was neurological.
And was it insidious, meaning it grew very slowly, or did this happen like she was here and then it just dropped?
Well, Alzheimer's is interesting in all forms of dementia, which it's one of. It can happen in a lot of ways. For us, it was a slow drip, drip, drip type of torture, where things would get bad or get strange, and then everything would be fine for a while. And then it was sort of like plateauing down, and then it stayed this way, then it dropped, and then it stayed this way. And then finally, toward the end, it was just a glide into oblivion.
And how far into this Alzheimer's did you seek help with doctors, or was it 2 or 3 years out, or 5 years out, or
closer to 5 years?
So you didn't, you really, yeah, because sure. Because you didn't know what was going on.
Yeah, I thought she was maybe, you know, burnt out. I thought she maybe was having a nervous breakdown. I thought about a whole host of things, and we were so close. I didn't want to believe that this woman who could do, literally she could do everything, and she made everything look effortless, and she was always kind, and then all of a sudden it'd be like me talking to you now and I go, I don't like this. And you go, where did that come from? And then all of a sudden she'd go, oh honey, how are you? And you don't know, we wrote a book called Before I Forget, and I call it the WTF period, because you don't know what to expect. All of a sudden, it's like a clear, sunny day, and then there's hail, and there's lightning, and there's wind, and then all of a sudden, everything's calm again, and it could be like that for weeks. And then then what happens is those distances between the storm get shorter and shorter in duration, and that's when you start to put two and two together. Some people don't want to believe it, even when they tell them it's that, because they just don't want to face the facts.
Mm-hmm. And so what did you do? Where did you go for help? Did you go to the hospital, or
yeah,
did you, and what did they say to you?
Well, my daughter, our daughter, her stepdaughter, but really her daughter because she raised her, started to notice, and she was removed because she wasn't living with us, and she would come back and she could see it, and I was right on top of the situation. And finally, I called up a buddy named Bobby Friedman, and he was affiliated with Mount Sinai, and I went to see a woman named Jane Martin, and we had cognitive tests taken, and the same kind of test that the president asked to take, and those little things that you find they can't do suddenly say there's something going on that's more than just memory loss. And once we did that, we went and had a beta amyloid test, and we saw that there was plaque in the brain. And that's when she realized, and she was strong, she started reading all about it. And she knew this was going to kill her. She knew it. Mm-hmm. She knew you don't get out of Alzheimer's. It's one way. And when we got the test results, we walked from 101st Street to right around 93rd, 92nd Street. And she turned to me and she said, tell the story, Dan. You tell the story. Don't let anybody else tell the story. And she says, there's going to come a time when you're going to need to be with someone, or you're going to be lonely. And you love me. I know you love me. but I don't want you to go 10, 15, 20 years by yourself. And that's how it happened.
And what advice would you give to a family who discovers that a family member now has Alzheimer's?
Well, the biggest thing, the toughest language in the world to learn is not Mandarin or Arabic, it's patience. You have to be a patient person because you're going to go through a living hell. You're going to deal with things that you couldn't imagine a person could do. And you have to lie, you have to not tell the truth. When they're asking you how you're feeling and you've been up all night and you stubbed your toe or they broke a glass and you stepped on the glass, or someone for the umpteenth time is telling you how you should do something and they're not sitting there, which is mostly most of the family members who do the least, but want to tell you what to do because they're feeling guilty, you have to have patience.
Patience and empathy, right?
And you have to make sure that you give the person dignity and you also maintain your own sanity.
Because it's a tough thing to live
with. 4 out of 10 people predecease the person they're caring for. Or they get sick.
4 out of 10?
Yeah, 4 out of 10.
Because they can't handle it.
Yeah. And, you know, and a lot of people, I was determined not to warehouse her.
And you didn't put her in an assisted living program, and you stayed with her.
I sold our beach house because she was escaping and going to the American Hotel, which she loved, and wandering. And I got to a point where I realized I had to try to build a place that had a gate and was fenced in. And we made it. She lived as good a life as you could for the time she had. That I'm proud of my daughter, and I'm proud of I'm proud of what I did because I was not gonna warehouse her.
And you were with her all the time, which is extraordinary. Now, you had a relationship with a woman while you were living with your wife, and I understand this woman, Alex Lerner, moved into your
No. See, she never lived there. That was an angry woman. We had 7 bedrooms. There was a room that she could stay and put stuff, or if she wanted to bring somebody, or she wanted to, if it was kids or whatever.
And this was in New York, or no, in
this was out here.
Out here in
Sag
Harbor.
But the press, and because of the racial situation,
she's white.
Yeah,
Alex,
she's white.
Yes.
Yeah. The press and certain people had a field day with that. My wife dated white men, Asian men. I dated white, black, whatever. Some people are not comfortable with that, and they took it upon themselves. But Alex Lerner never lived in my house. She was there on weekends twice a month, and I would go into town and I'd stay at her place on occasion, a day or two or whatever. But it was such a hot topic for a lot of people who
I remember reading about
who deal in salaciousness. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. But no, she never lived in there. Mm-hmm. She never. And
how did B respond to this?
She was very kind to B when she was there. B is a lovely, even through Alzheimer's, even when she was angry. What was funny, my daughter and I still laugh at it, when she, they have a tendency, some people are really violent or really mean. Mm-hmm. She never cursed, and when she got upset with something, she would make up words because she couldn't figure out how to say curse words, and we would just laugh, and then she'd start laughing. So her spirit and her soul was always
she was kind. A lady.
She, you know what?
A good soul and a lady and
amazing.
God dealt at the end a bad deck of cards.
Yeah.
It was a bad ending, a hard ending for her and for you.
Yeah.
And now are you and Alex together anymore?
No, she took off and, whatever.
And you're healing from the loss of
I wish her well, mm-hmm. I mean, life has a way of whatever you deserve, you'll ultimately get. And that's fine,
And now you've gotten involved, you're on the board of a charity that works with people with Alzheimer's. And what's the name of that charity?
I'm on the board of the American Brain Foundation. And one of the things that I realized is that the only way to try to solve this is that the brain is really the game. You know, most people don't realize that there are about 400 different brain diseases. Most people don't realize that whether it's ALS, or it's epilepsy, or it's Tourette's syndrome, or it's Lewy body disease, which Robin Williams died from, or Parkinson's. It all goes back, it's a neurological disease, and it all starts at the top, above your eyebrows and underneath your hair. It starts in that 2.5 to 3.5 pound mass of white and gray matter. And so I realized if I was gonna make a difference, I just didn't wanna talk about Alzheimer's. I wanted the heart disease, lung disease, kidney disease, cancer, all get liver disease, all have done a better job marketing their diseases, ovarian cancer, but the brain is still far behind, but it's the most important organ of the body. It literally
controls pretty much everything.
Well, you're only a mammal if you don't have your brain. You're not a human being.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you can replace, you know, parts of your eyes, you can replace your kneecaps, you can replace heart, but you can't replace the brain. That's where your humanity resides.
Well, we have to learn more about how to care for our brains and then about how it works. And I think science is a long way off from solving these problems. But there are groups like the Rita Hayworth Foundation,
yes,
that are involved in research, and your charity that is involved in research. And then people have to hear from people like you, Dan, to learn what they can do should they be in a situation where someone near and dear to them is coming down with Alzheimer's or has Alzheimer's, because it's a rocky road and it's a tough road for most caregivers and then for family members. And I think you've done a pretty decent job of number one, getting through it, and I feel for you because I feel like you've suffered a lot and it's been a hard thing for you, and I'm just praying and hoping that now, because you're a wonderful man, and you and your wife were always so loved as a couple, and now you're on your own, and I'm just hoping that you're going to have another life, life moving forward where you find a new partner and someone that can make you happy, and I'm also looking at you as someone who can share your experiences like you're doing now and as you've done before with the world. And I hope you have the platform and the chance moving forward to help more and more people, because so many people who go through this or who are just beginning to go through this don't know what to experience. And it's a tough road.
It is. You know.
And I have so much compassion for you, for your daughter, and for all your critics.
Let me say something.
I feel bad. I feel bad.
You know what?
It was a tough situation you were in, for sure.
If I had to do it over again,
it was perfect.
I have no regrets about that. But you know what I learned? I learned about strength. I learned I now know the difference between a strong person and a weak person.
Mm-hmm.
I now know the difference between, I know what love is, because I had love. I also know that in life, sometimes people come into your life for a period of time and then
they disappear.
They poof.
Mm.
You know, they can't handle it.
Mm-hmm.
And you can try to make them look as good as you can, but they can't handle it. But if I had to do it all over again, I would go through it. Because you know what wisdom is? Wisdom is not being smart. It's not being smart. It's knowing what's important. And I've suffered. I've taken hits. I mean, people tried to poison my dogs because of that relationship. People tried to, they sent the protective services because of that relationship. I've got spat on because of that relationship. People don't know these types of things. I would go through it again because I can look anyone in the eye and tell them, You got to be strong, because the thing that matters the most is that person who can't take care of themselves.
Very, very true. And back to racial justice and the racial injustice that we've had. is this an area that you would personally get want to be a spokesperson for and try to help out? I think it's so important that we get through these barriers and move forward, because the history of our country has been a really rugged, in many ways, a very, 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 very difficult one for people of color. And I look and I say, our history should have never been what it was. And I hope you take this on. I really
do. Well, Jean, thank you. You know what? I've always been honest. I grew up in a very diverse world. I know.
As I did.
Yeah, as you did. And if you don't tackle something head on, there are a lot of people out here who talk a talk, but they don't walk the walk. You know, it's not about donating. It's about what are you doing to help the people that really need the donations. It's not about putting placards on your wall saying that you love black people and you don't do anything about that, or Hispanic people, or gay people, or people who are not considered part of what is called the quote-unquote mainstream. I've always believed that. I've always stood. I've never been afraid not to take a shot. And I've found that a lot of people, sometimes you're very close, they can't handle it.
Well, I think people need to come together. They need to socialize together. Mm-hmm. And then we all have to work together.
Yeah.
And part of it is of philanthropy, is advocating, it's donating, and it's volunteering. And we're just about out of time. Dan, how can people donate to?
I would ask anybody that out. First of all, you do a great job, and philanthropy is so important. I'm a member of the American Brain Foundation, the ABF.
And how can we donate? Because we have less than 30 seconds left.
You can go online to abf.com and they will help. I also work and have worked with the Alzheimer's Association, the Alzheimer's Foundation. But the most important thing I can say is we need to donate, because the brain you save may eventually be your own.
So very true. Thank you, Dan, so much for being with us. This concludes today's episode of Successful Philanthropy. With us today was Dan Gasby. I'm Jean Shafiroff, your host. I'll see you next week.